All right, well, let's get going this week. Last week, we finished up in Romans 16:6, and we looked at the controversial teachings on whether Phoebe was a deacon or a deaconess, or was she a servant? And we talked about that, then we saw what an outstanding servant of Christ Phoebe was, and finished up talking a little about Priscilla and Aquila. Now, I don't know what you guys talk about on the car ride home, but my car ride home last week was a discussion of spelling rules. Because last week, I wrote the word weird on the board, right? That's the proper spelling, right? I before E, except after C, and sometimes Y. The spelling of weird is weird. So remember that for my mistakes, which is now on the World Wide Web for all of eternity. That's well, yeah, that's true. But oh, and then I just wrote, you know, you talk about KJV, KJB. Well, those are interchangeable, so I wrote KJB. And my wife is sitting there thinking, my husband's always been a good speller. What's wrong with him? You know, she thought I was having a brain tumor or a stroke or something. So that was from last week. The spelling of weird is weird. I told you at the end of last week that we were dealing with Romans 16:7 this week. And we're going to make it all the way down to verse 16 this week. But the majority of the time, I want to talk about this one verse. Romans 16:7, and this was a verse that was used to bonk me on the head and beat me up and try to pull me away from Paul in times past. And it was used to harm my understanding, and it was a very difficult thing for me to see and overcome. So let's read the verse here. Romans 16 and verse 7. Salute Andy and June, Andronicus and Junia, my kinsmen and my fellow prisoners who are of note among the apostles who were in Christ before me. Now, I know you all want to hear this, but I'm going to bog down a little bit on this week. I'm going to get a little bit boring and go into some minutia and some doctrine. And, you know, that's not what most people come to church to get. Most people come to church because they want to emote. You have the singing and the entertainment, and then you get the emotion, and you emote, and you walk out feeling like you've emoted, and everything's wonderful. But what I'm going to ask you all to do this week is something that's pretty rare in the church houses, and I'm going to ask you to think critically, and to discern, and pay attention to what's going on, so hopefully you can be saved from the trouble that I went through with this verse. Now, I said I'm going to get boring and get technical, so I thought, what's a way I can make this a little bit more interesting? So I thought I'd do something that I'm sure I do from time to time accidentally, but this week I'm going to do it on purpose. I'm going to spend a few minutes teaching you something wrong. I'm going to teach error, and it's going to be an exercise for all of you to do better than I did and play spot the error, because I sure didn't for a long time. So I'm going to teach error to make a point, and this is stuff I've swallowed hook, line, and sinker. I was sitting right there in this assembly looking up to my pastor who loved me and I loved him, and he taught me this error, and I just nodded my head like, and I agreed with it. So I want you to, like I said, learn from my mistakes, learn from my poor workmanship, learn from where I messed up, so that when the time comes when it's time for you to be a minister or an ambassador for these things, that you've already know this stuff ahead of time and you've learned from my wrong. So, and that, you know, that was a really hard thing for me too, because I had to come to a choice, because I love this man. I mean, I sat directly with him in this class for all this time, and it's hard when you love somebody, but you know, this is wrong. Because what's true and what's right is not beholden to whether I love someone or they love me. What's true, what's right, true and right, whether I love you or hate you or couldn't care less about you. And that's what we, what's that?
We asked the pastor to step down too, just to clarify that in here.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Well, obviously, because he's not here. I'll get into that later.
Okay. All right.
But like I said, what's true and what's right, true and right, regardless of affections, admirations, you know, knowledge, wisdom, all that. So I'd like to teach the wrong thing now, and we'll see if any of you catch it. The phrase, in Christ. I've written this on the board, in Christ. This is almost exclusively unique to Paul. I'm telling you what, one thing I've noticed is that when you're up here and you're speaking one thing and you're writing another thing and you're thinking about the next thing you're going to say, all of a sudden you become a spelling idiot. It's just, it's a phenomenon. But it's true, I don't know. But it's almost entirely unique to Paul. 75 of the 78 times you see this phrase, in Christ, it's in Paul's writing, in Christ. And we all know by now that we would be wrong to think that doctrine written to people in the pre-Old Testament, prior to Exodus 19, is our doctrine. We know that. We'd also be wrong to think that the Old Testament law was doctrine for us today. We are the church. We are the body of Christ. So we are not under the law. We're not under the law. Now, and we know that Paul's ministry, I got that right. Oh, no. Maybe I should quit while I'm behind. That was not the error I was trying to...
We tried to leave it alone.
No, please help me, please. Please. Talk about a good sermon illustration right there. I'm an idiot. Anyways. Yes.
I ain't under the law.
I ain't under the law. We all know my West Virginia roots. I tell you what, it's funny. I had to go down to West Virginia on Friday. And it's like when you cross that river, it's, oh, my people. You know?
You get your false
teeth. Yeah. Anyways. But Paul's ministry, we know that we're not under the law, we're under grace, and we know Paul's ministry is to those in Christ. In Christ. We know all that's true. And of course we know from that Paul is the apostle to the Gentiles, and for goodness sake, we're a bunch of filthy Gentiles in here. That's Paul's ministry. He's the apostle to the Gentiles, and Paul's the one that teaches us about the body of Christ. Okay? You know all these things. 2 Timothy 1:11 says, "Whereunto I am appointed a preacher, and an apostle, and a teacher of the Gentiles." All right? And if you're in Christ, that means biblically you're part of the body of Christ. You're people who have heard the gospel of the grace of God. You're saved, sealed, and delivered by grace alone, through faith alone, and your object of faith alone, the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. We know that. And you don't have any works associated with your faith. You trust the works that have already been done. So being in Christ is very distinctive to our dispensation. And anytime you see somebody in Christ, you know it's talking to you. Turn back to Romans 12. Romans 12 and verse 5. "And we, being many, are one body in Christ, and everyone members one of another." I forgot to write this on the board. Did anybody spot the big fat lie that I just told you? No one. Good. Makes me feel better because I didn't spot it either when I heard it. I just told you a big fat lie, something completely untruthful. And I said it very blithely and very slickly, and I sauteed it with a bunch of truth all around it. And I was wrong. And you didn't catch it. Like I said, with it makes me feel better because I didn't catch it either. Like I said, I nodded my head up and down. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So let's go over a list of the true things I just said. True thing, 75 of 78 times in Christ is unique to the Apostle Paul. True thing. We'd be wrong to think that we're under the law or under some kind of covenant or performance system. We're not under that. We are under grace. That was the true thing I said. We are the church which is his body, Colossians 1:18. Paul's ministry was to those of us in Christ. That's a true thing I just said. That's true. Those of us who are members of the body of Christ, those of us who are saved by grace through faith during the dispensation of God's grace. I said another true thing, which I forgot to write on the board. We are sinful Gentiles. And Paul's ministry was to us sinful Gentiles. And he's the one that teaches us about the body of Christ. Those are all true things I just said to you. So where was the error? All of those things are true. Isn't that everything you just said, Steve? I thought that's everything you just said, Steve. It's not all I just said. I just fed you a big fat lie. And like I said, it's a lie that I bought. When I first started that school, we started studying 1 Corinthians and Romans, and this was told to me very early in the book of 1 Corinthians. And it didn't. It was something that was taught wrong. And the guy, by the way, the guy who was teaching me, he doesn't think he's teaching me wrong. He thinks he's teaching right doctrine, and he loved me, and he would never lead me off the rails on purpose, but he did. And he planted this seed, and that seed didn't germinate till much later on when I'm seeing and I'm studying. There's something really distinct about the Apostle Paul. Something's changed here. This is something that's way different from Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. This is something that's way different from James and Hebrews and Revelation. There's something here. And that's when that seed came forth, and this verse, Romans 16:7, our subject verse, was used to try to beat me back. Because the question that most people ask, I'll just write it over here. In your Bible, when you're going through, the question is, where do I plant my flag? Where's my doctrine? Is it the Gospels? Most people think it is. Most people plant their flag there and say, this is Jesus' instructions for me. I'm following Jesus. And there's a lot of churches where Acts 2 is my doctrine. That's where I plant my flag. That's where the whole Bible revolves around that. And then, you know, there's those of us who see something in Paul starting in Acts 9. So the question is, where do you plant your flag? And I was starting to see, you know, as a kid, I'm here. I called it the whatever works dispensationalism. Whatever my agenda is this week, if I can find a verse somewhere, that's my doctrine. And then, you know, you start to see, well, maybe it's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Well, then, well, no, because those people were technically Old Testament, so that can't really be me. And then you start moving farther and farther. And I was starting to see that I need to move my flag and plant my flag over here. And the gentleman who taught me used Romans 16:7 to try to bring me back to Acts 2 and back into Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And that's why I'm spending so much time on it. But I've told you an egregious, erroneous thing, and I've wrapped it quite nicely in a bunch of truth, a fourfold pile of truth. They say the best lies are the ones that have a little bit of truth in them. I say, no, the best lies are the ones that have a whole bunch of truth in them, because it's harder to spot if it's surrounded by a bunch of true things. But here's the error that I just told you. I laid a trap for you by saying all these things, and that hid the lie I told you. The lie I told you, if you are in Christ, I give up. Huh? Okay. The lie I told you is, if you're in Christ, biblically, that means you're in the body. Church, which is his body, the mystery body, which from other ages and generations was not made known to men, but now is manifest. I told you that if you're in Christ, biblically, that means you are in the body of Christ, which puts you in the dispensation of God's grace, which puts you under the revelation of the mystery. That's the lie I told you. That's the lie that was told to me. Now, why does that matter? Let's look back at Romans 16:7 for a second. Remember, I just told you, it's unique to Paul 75 to 78 times. Paul's ministry was to those of us in Christ, sinful Gentiles. You're not under the law. You're in Christ. Here's the problem. Romans 16:7. Salute Andy and June, my kinsmen, my fellow prisoners, who are note among the apostles, who were in Christ before me. What do you do with that? In Christ before me. Houston, we have a problem. What do you do with somebody being in Christ before the first of all, the me first pattern? What do you do with that? Well, obviously, you know, we need to go back to Acts 2 then, right? Nothing's unique here. Paul's just continuing on with the apostles' ministry. Nothing to see here. What do you do with it? I didn't know what to do with that. Okay. Well, maybe every, you know, the 30 other verses I've saw that have really been making me think that I need to move into Acts 9, maybe those are wrong. What do I do? What do I do? So, we have on one hand in 1 Timothy 1:16 saying, howbeit for this cause I obtain mercy, that in me, after Andy and June, no, in me first, Jesus Christ might show forth all longsuffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting. We have that verse saying it's me first. I'm the pattern. And I you know, I was talking with a gentleman and I said, you have to understand the significance of what happened on the road to Damascus. Because all the way through your Bible, starting Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, all the way up to there, God is dealing with people who are obedient and people who are listening to his commands and people who are following his covenants and following what he said, tells them to do for righteousness. And for the first time, you see God, the Lord Jesus Christ, comes down to enemy number one and says, I'm going to save my sworn enemy. That's huge. That's a big deal. That shows a giant dispensational shift that God is now going to save his enemies. All right? So we have some dueling verses. And we have Ephesians 3:2. If you've heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you word. The question is, how could the dispensation be given to him, to everybody else, if there were others before him? What do? We've got dueling verses now. We have contradicting information, apparently. So how could somebody be in Christ before Paul? I thought Paul was the one that laid the foundation. I thought he was the wise master builder. What do I do? Well, I could just listen to my teacher and do what he tells me to do, because now I'm confused and I don't know what to do. Or I could study myself to show myself approved. But the fact of the matter is, with what I've said here, on one hand, you can't say in me first and others before me. Those are opposite statements. You can't say in me first and others were before me. So how can these things be so? If you're confused, that's good. Because I was confused, and that means that you're all no better than me, which is encouraging. But it doesn't make sense. And we're left with, what do we do? And what I want to do today is to show you what I subsequently learned so you won't fall prey to the same thing I did. Because I fell prey to the oldest trick in the book. And like I said, the guy that was teaching me, he didn't know he was tricking me. He bought into what was wrong, believing it. He loved his teacher, and he taught it to me. He would never lead me wrong on purpose. But what I've done is I've set up the oldest trick in the book. And this is a great illustration because I don't have to write words. What am I? I have just fed you a straw man argument. That's how I hid the lie. I've told you something that wasn't true, and then based on that untruth, I'm trying to move you in a different way than following your apostle. The straw man argument. And, you know, like I said, the best lies are the ones wrapped in a lot of truth. And that's the straw man. This right here is the straw man argument that I told you. That error. And I know I've stated it before, but never let the ignorant define the terms. Because somebody who's ignorant of the mystery of Christ, or somebody who's ignorant of something, if you let them define the terminology, then you've lost, because you've bought into the straw man, and there's nowhere to go but their way. It's like the old thing with what is the elect in your Bible. If you let a lot of people and a lot of different denominations define the elect, they define it erroneously. Therefore, the only way to go is from error. Or we know in your Bible the elect is either Christ or Israel. But if you let somebody define for you, well, the elect is people who God picked to be saved, that's a straw man. That's wrong. That's a wrong definition from your Bible. Your Bible does not define that way. All right? So the straw man is, if you're in Christ, that means biblically you're part of the body of Christ. All right? And this comes from Florida, from a guy who, you know, on one hand will say you're under grace, and on the other hand he'll try to bring law back into your walk with Christ. All right, and we know from people who are trying to teach the law that ends up in vain jangling, right? We know that from Timothy. So, let me say this. While this is true, it's unique that the phrase in Christ is very unique to the Apostle Paul, 75 to 78 times. That's a true statement. The phrase is unique to Paul. But if you take the step that means biblically, if you're in Christ, you're in the body of Christ, you've got a straw man problem. That's taking a logical step that's not there. All right? And it comes with enormous doctrinal ramifications. And you don't know it. It's like I said, that seed was planted for me. And I didn't think anything of it. You know, we're just going through and studying. It's cool. And I didn't know the doctrinal ramifications that were going to sprout up from that later. But it's huge. It's, you know, it's like saying, well, I'm in a church. So that means I'm in the church baptized unto Moses under the wilderness. Let's go kill an animal, right? Let's go to temple on Saturday. Get rid of the pork. Let's see some miracles and signs. There's ramifications when you say, just because I'm in a church, I'm in this. You could be, are we in the Acts 2 church? You all drove your own cars here. You're all wearing your own clothes and you have your own money in the bank. What's wrong with us? There's doctrinal ramifications for where you plant your flag in the Bible. All right, and similarly, there are ramifications if you accept that argument. And you're putting yourself, if you accept that, you're putting yourself in a dispensation where, let's just, top of the list, what's the gospel? What's the object of faith? You're putting yourself, if you accept that, if being in Christ means biblically you're in the body of Christ, you've just taken away your eternal security that you love. You are now eternally insecure, right? You have to endure to the end now. You have to not take the mark of the beast. It's a dangerous place to be. But did anybody think about all that when I was going through and telling my own truth? And, you know, what's the point here, Steve? What are you getting at? Now it's kind of a bigger deal. All right? So let me cut to the chase here. If you make in Christ biblically mean you're in the mystery body, if you swallow that lie, you've boxed yourself into a corner where your Bible only has two things in it, Old Testament and New Testament. Everybody's under a covenant. Everybody's in some kind of a performance system where they've got faith as the object of their, or works and as the part of their object of faith. You've boxed yourself into a corner that's trouble, because you've now taken the 100 pages or so of the mystery, and now you're going to try to fit a square peg into a round hole or a round peg into a square hole. You've got trouble now. And you fail to see now the distinctiveness, the real distinctiveness of Paul and his ministry and the dispensation which God committed to him. So what do we do with this? Romans 16:7, Andy and June, in Christ before me. The best way to cure ignorance is by learning something, right? So let's light our straw man. I'm sure he'll burn well. He's strong. It's been dry for a while. We got to burn up the straw man. We got to figure out if this statement is true or not. And we go back to study. Is that a true statement? And you can cure ignorance by careful study. Careful. And I found out that from study, that being in Christ does not necessarily mean biblically that you're in the mystery body of Christ. That's the true statement. All right? And I can, when I say that this phrase, yes, the phrase is uniquely Pauline, in Christ. I mean, 75 of 78 times. That's a big deal. That phrase is definitely unique to Paul. But the concept of being in Christ is not exclusive to the Apostle Paul. When I say in Christ, I'm not talking about in the mystery body. I'm talking about the concept of being in Christ is not exclusively Pauline. And you know that because you can read. And we all have access to computers and Bible study software. And if we run into a brick wall, like, what do I do with this, with Andy and June? We can look things up, all right? Now, obviously, if you're looking for the concept of being in Christ, you're going to want to lean more towards where Christ is named in the Bible, right? Being in Christ, you're not necessarily going to find that when Jehovah God's dealing with Israel. You know, it's all about Jehovah. So you want to look to where Christ has been named. Like I said before, many people who oppose mid-acts, Pauline, dispensational, mystery of Christ, whatever you want to call it, they want to bring you back and they say the church started in Acts 1 and 2. Where if you read Acts 1 and 2, nothing started. It's the beginning of the end of Israel. Peter says, this is that which was spoken by Joel. Well, the good news is I can go back and read Joel and find out what that was about. It wasn't the birthday of anything, all right? But they do that because all they see is Israel's Old Testament, Israel's New Testament. That's all they see in their Bibles, and we know that there's more than that. And that's where, when you study, you can see, okay, there's a problem with that statement there. All right, there's a problem with being in Christ, being part of the mystery body, because I can find references of people in the Old Testament being in Christ. All right? And that's the problem with the letting the ignorant define the terms. Turn to the book of John. John 6. Now, John 6, we know according to Hebrews 9, this is Old Testament because the death of the testator had not occurred. But not only in John 6 are we in the Old Testament, but we're in a spot where nobody, we're talking the guys who are walking around with Christ, have no clue the cross is coming. They know nothing about it. So not only is it Old Testament, but these guys don't know anything about the cross. Meanwhile, how do we get in Christ? We trust the cross. We trust the death, burial, and resurrection. All right? Now, this is a favorite verse. This is what the Roman Catholics use to justify eating the Jesus cookie and drinking the blood of Jesus. There, they cannibalize Jesus every week. It is an odd statement by Jesus, but then he makes the point later in the chapter. I'm not talking about literally gnawing on my arm, people. My words are spirit and life, okay? But they couldn't read that far, apparently. But in John 6, in verse 56, he says, "He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him." Who's talking? Christ. He's saying, you do this, you dwell in me, in Christ, and I in you. So there's somebody in the Old Testament with no knowledge of the death, burial, and resurrection, no knowledge of the cross, being in Christ. All right, turn ahead to John 14. And the reason you know that John 6 is before anybody knows about the cross is you can cross-refer it to Matthew 14 to get the timeline in the Gospels. But in John 14:20, "At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you." Ye in Christ, I in you. How did they get in Christ is the question. On what basis are they in Christ is the real question. We see in verse 21, "He that hath my commandments and keepeth them." We got commandment keeping now. "He it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and I will manifest him." So we see the concept here of somebody being in Christ, and it's not based on trusting the death, burial, and resurrection. It's talking about Hey, you love me, you're going to keep my commandments. It's about doing things. Turn ahead one page to John 15. John 15 and verse 5. I am the vine, ye are the branches. Everybody knows this verse. He that abideth, where? In me, and I in him. He that abideth in Christ, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me. So here we have people in a situation where they can choose to abide not in Christ. We don't have that choice. Once we're in Christ, Ephesians 1:13, we are sealed. How long, Steve? How long are you sealed? Till you become room temperature. Ephesians 4:30, we're sealed until the day of redemption, the redemption of our bodies. I cannot choose to abide not in Christ, and neither can you if you're in him. But these people in this setting can. It's different. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, here, I wish I had this promise, right? Ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. All right, we know that's not true, because I prayed for it to be 65 and sunny today, and it's not. It's hotter than 65. I'm being silly. But what I'm trying to prove here is that, yes, the phrase in Christ is very unique to Paul. But the concept of being in Christ, right, you can find it in Israel's New Testament, you can find it in Israel's Old Testament, and it's based on different things, different objects of faith. So when I make that statement, boy, I've just made a heap big trouble for all of our doctrinal understanding. That's why study helps. And they, what these verses prove is how fat my big fat lie was. All right? That proves that. Now, like I said, we're in Christ based on trusting what he did for us. We're not of works because the works have already been done. God manifest in the flesh died for my sins. Back to John. Oh, I already said that. Never mind. I'm repeating myself. You can tell I'm doing these sermons late at night when tired. But that's the thing. I'd like to maybe demonstrate. Sorry, straw man. Let me just cast you into the fire as a branch. But the concept of being in Christ The concept begs a question. How are you in Christ? Are you in Christ according to prophecy or mystery? Because you can be in Christ both ways, in your Bible, biblically. These folks here, following the prophetic program in the book of John, they were in Christ based on keeping his commandments and doing what he said and following him, literally. He said, follow me. Going to Caesarea. Follow me. Let's go. But we are in Christ based on something that was not revealed till the me first pattern heard about it. Hey, Saul of Tarsus, enemy number one. I'm going to save you. I've got work for you to do. I'm going to give usher in a whole new dispensation. I'm going to halt the prophetic program, and I'm going to show grace, mercy, and peace to all humanity based on what I did for them. So you can be in Christ according to different dispensational settings. But only the people who are in Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery, are in Christ based on trusting the death, burial, and the resurrection. That we know because we can read. But those of us who trust according to the mystery, those of us are the people who are going to heavenly places, the people who are predestinated to serve Christ and glorify him throughout all eternity in heavenly places. We know that's true. I remember it was so many years ago, I heard this some guy make a statement to me, and I know I repeat it from time to time. Nobody in your Bible ever wanted to die and go to heaven until they heard it from Paul. And when he first said that to me, what? Because it was such a bizarre statement. Everybody wants to die and go to heaven. That's what I've been hearing my whole life, you know? And they mix it like, you know, you read verses, well, they're on earth and they're in a kingdom, and, you know, people are dying if they don't obey, but that's heaven, and we're... You know, we go up and down, you know, it's like a yo-yo. Up and down, heaven one day, kingdom the next day. It didn't make any sense, but then, And when he said that to me, it's like, I wonder if that's true. Nobody wanted to die and go to heaven until they heard it from Paul. And then you study it out and you realize, whoa, everybody in the Bible till Paul planned on being with God on earth. Everybody. Job, I know I'll see my Redeemer and he will stand on the earth. And it's, you know, it's an amazing thing. But here's an interesting little secret. You know, we're talking about, can you be in Christ and not be in the mystery body of Christ? I've got news for you. Turn to Ephesians 1. Can that be true? If I'm not in the mystery body, can I be in Christ? The concept. Once again, I know the phrase, the way it's said is unique. We're talking about the concept of being in Christ. Is it possible? I've shown you proof of the disciples in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John being in Christ. Here's something that's even a little bit more bold in its statement. Ephesians 1:9. Having made known unto us the mystery of his will according to the good pleasure which he has purposed in himself, verse 10, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, so here we have a future dispensation that we really don't have much information about, he might gather together in one, how many things? A-L-L, our favorite detergent, all things in Christ. And the all things is a list of two. All consists of two. That's easy. Both which are in heaven. Hey, that's us. Yay. And what's the other part? And which are on earth, even in him. Everyone who responded positively to their object of faith in every dispensation, all throughout history, is going to end up in Christ. By the works of the law shall no flesh be justified, right? That payment, that blood payment was for A-L-L, all, regardless of what their object of faith was. So everybody ends up in Christ. So it's not just, well, can I not be in the mystery body and be in Christ? You can't be in a right, you can't be outside of hell and not be in Christ. Let's put it that way. You had to have responded positively to what God said. So that, I hope that exercise wasn't as boring as it could have been. But like I said, what I wanted to do there is insulate you from the error that I made. Because it really tore me up. And what do I do? Because I, like I said last week, I come to this and I believe these words. I can't change the words, but I can't understand this. We have two things saying opposite things. I thought they were saying opposite things, but they weren't. Study cured it. And I hope it cures it for all of you in case somebody comes along to you and wants to ask you to move your flag in your Bible. But as if there wasn't enough on verse 7. Like I said, we're making it to verse 16 today. But we're spending almost all the time on verse 7. There's one more thing. Just one more thing. The rest of the story here in verse 7. Who are in Christ before me. Hopefully now that's ho-hum instead of so we dealt with that. There's another thing here. The middle of the sentence. Who are of note among the apostle? Andronicus and Junia, who are of note among the apostles. What's that all about? And the question that you have to answer we've got here Andy and June. Are they of note among the apostles? Like they're part of the apostles? Or are they of note among the people who are actually apostles? Did it again. This is not the place for a spelling bee. But are they of note among the apostles as if they're apostles themselves and they're notable apostles among other apostles? Or are they of note to those people who were apostles? Are they notable to those people? Like, hey, heard of Andy and June? They're great. All of us apostles love them. How do you read that? And it's not entirely clear here. I will tell you that I myself, after looking at it, I diverge from even the guy who ordained me, and the way I understand it is I see them as being of note among those people who are apostles. They're not apostles themselves, but they're notable among them. That's how I see it. I don't see them as actual apostles themselves. And how do I get there? Well, we just spent all this time talking about Paul's the me first pattern, right? And we just saw that they were in Christ before Paul. So if they're in Christ before Paul, most likely they're lining up with the kingdom Israel and the little flock, all right? And we know that Jesus chose 12, one of them betrayed him, and they cast lots and picked Matthias. So there was 12 apostles, they're going to sit on 12 thrones and 12 gates in the kingdom. So if they're in Christ before Paul, chances are they're with that crowd. So that would make you think, okay, well, they're not apostles themselves because Christ chose 12. That's one way I get to that. And the second thing is, to the best I can tell, Junia is a female name. It seems like Andy and June, Andronicus and Junia, probably husband and wife. And, okay, so it's a female name. Well, you know, I don't want to be chauvinistic here. Let's see if there are any other female apostles. So I go through in my Bible study, so I can't find another female apostle. If there's doubt, I'm going to go with, I can't find another female apostle. Maybe God didn't choose any females to hold that office. And then, as we talked about last week, the office is in a church of bishop and deacon that seems to be reserved for men, just as the leadership of the home is reserved for men. So, okay, that's more evidence where Junia was probably not an apostle herself, and neither was Andronicus. So that's how I see it on that. That's not earth-shattering to understand that one way or another, but I will tell you, man, there are website after website promoting this Junia of women apostles, and they just go on and on and on about the people like me who just hate women. You know, we learned last week that I don't hate women, other women hate women. But, what's that?
Sort of like Luke. I've always been fascinated with Luke, you know, how much knowledge he had of Christ, like Matthew, Mark, Luke. You know,
right, right.
Apostle, but he obviously...
He was not.
He was there, knew all that stuff, and then he also with Paul. I mean,
yeah.
It was really to see that transition they mm-hmm. saw, and he was in Christ, and that's it. And then
yeah, so, he's the one that basically recorded from the beginning of here's the Messiah showing up, all the way through the rejection, all the way through the crucifixion, all the way through, you know, the what is this? This mystery revealed, and he recorded all of that. It's, That's an interesting life to live, to see all that happen in one lifetime, you know. We live in rather more boring times, but hooray for Luke, right? Okay, real quick, and we'll be done. There's 22 names in the next few verses. 22 names. We just spent all that time on Romans 16:7, so I'm just going to go through all this. These 22 people here named, can't find them anywhere else in the Bible. One mention in the Bible. Meanwhile, that's one more than I got. So good for them. But when you go down through this, you know, I talked about last week, as you read through all these salutations that Paul gives these people, it's all about the work they're doing and the faithfulness and how beloved they are. Greet, this will be fun. I'll try to pronounce all these things. Greet Amplius, my beloved in the Lord. Salute Urbane, our helper in Christ. And Stachys, my beloved. Salute Apelles, approved in Christ. Salute them which are of Aristobulus' household. Salute Herodian, my kinsman. Greet them that be of the household of Narcissus. Narcissus. That was a fun house to be in. Just kidding. Salute Tryphena and Tryphosa, who labor in the Lord. See, there's that work again. They're working. And look at right after that. We got Tryphena and Tryphosa, who labor in the Lord. And then salute the beloved Persis, who labored much in the Lord. So we got people who are working, and we got this other Persis who labored much. That reminds me of back when we studied Colossians, when he salutes the Colossians and he says, "Hello to the saints and to the faithful brethren." Lots of people are saints, but not everybody's a faithful brother. So we got laboring and laboring much. Verse 13, salute Rufus. That was the name of my favorite doll when I was a kid. Rufus, a monkey. Chosen in the Lord and his mother and mine. Salute, oh boy. Asyncritus, Phlegon, Hermas, Patrobus, Hermes, and the brethren which are with them. Salute Philogulus and Julia and Nereus and his sister and Olympias and all the saints that are with them. So that's 22 named people, plus sisters and mothers and saints with them and saints with them. There's a lot of folks there he's saying hi to. And if you look at the end of Paul's books, and like I said, Cody brought this to me a while ago. He's got a theory, which is kind of unprovable, but it's interesting nonetheless. We'll talk about it maybe next week, of why are there so many names here in the book of Romans? Why is he saying hi to so many people? But there's 22 people that he says hi to. And, you know, as I'm studying that and just reading down through this, and you see all these people who are laboring much, it just makes me think of the verses later in Paul's ministry where he says, all those in Asia are turned against me. Only Luke is with me. Isn't it amazing how, you know, things can change? People, Demas has forsaken me. He loves this present evil world. And that's what happened. But, you know, at this point in time, there was a lot of people to say hi to, and a lot of work got done, and we ourselves benefit from that. From these people, one mention, one name in the Bible, they were faithful. They preached the gospel. They equipped other people. And because of their workmanship and us standing on their shoulders all throughout time, here we are studying as well. So glory to God for that and for what he can do with even barrel scrapings like us, right? You're the barrel scrapings of Christ. So that is enough for 1 week. Let's close in several words of prayer. In the name of our Lord Jesus, by which we have access to God through what he did for us. And glory to God for that. Father, we're grateful to live in a country where we can still have a copy of your word, and we can read it, and we can talk about it openly, and we can meet openly without fear of goons coming in and shutting us down, and how much we take that for granted, the liberty that we still have to teach and to preach and to learn from your word. And I'm so grateful to be in a situation that we can do that, and our prayer is that all of us would take advantage of those opportunities and be faithful stewards of the mysteries and serve that office of ambassador for you, for your glory, and for souls to be saved and saints edified, being thankful to you for all eternity. I pray this in your name. Amen.